dear colleagues. As the moderator said, we are two ladies are going to make this presentation together. And why we are going to make it together is that we have worked together for 33 years. I started, the museum was established in 1985. I started in 1986, and my colleague, also called Molfri, started in 1987. So then we were a mechanic in addition, so we were 3 man-year. And last year we had 51 man-year. So we have grown a lot during this period. But where are we? Well, on the southwestern coast of Norway, you see. Here is our region. The museum was established by 7 municipalities surrounding the city of Stavanger. I don't know if you know, any of you know Stavanger, but Stavanger is also, we said, is the oil capital of Norway and is the most, and the county, capital of Rogaland. And we have a lot of small sites in this different municipalities. It's a very decentralized structure. But what we are going to talk about today is the two main sites, the science farm and the science factory. And as also the moderator said, this is a very important agricultural area in Norway. So that's very unlike the rest of Norway. It's not a typical Norwegian landscape, but it's a typical Jaeren landscape, this one. And as we said, the main sites is the science farm. As you see, in a rural setting, there is also the place where we had have our head office, and is the science factory in an urban setting. And what is important for us in a way is that it's complementary departments. The one, the science farm, is reflecting the agricultural history, and the science factory, the industrial history. But what is also interesting is the interaction between the agricultural production and the regional industry. And also the interaction between the rural and urban traditions of the region. So a bit more about the science farm. It's located outside a small community in Jaeren. And what is special with this site is that it's not only museum buildings. It's a whole cultural heritage area with about 70 different sites from the different historical periods. So we can, for instance, the Bronze Age burials and the Iron Age farms and so on. And so we can use this area as a living historical book to walk through different ages. And then we have a different historical farms. We have an old farm from the 18th, 19th century up there, and we have a farm established in 1878, but which today depicts the rural life in Jaeren in the 1950s. And what is also important is that we also use not only this landscape as a history book, we also use it as an education in biology and botanics and so on. And we also use the old people in the community to learn the youngsters how to keep the cultural landscape. because this is one of the small parts of the western coast of Norway where we have left some heather land, because most of the heather land has been cultivated. So we are trying to keep that heather land and even recover it. And here is the buildings, you see there. So it's a very, we have very different opportunities to show different part of our history just in this area. And then it's the science factory. That is our newest department. And especially due to that Stavanger and Sandnes was the European Capital of Culture in 2008. We got the money from both the municipality, the county, and especially from the cultural department or the government to get a new building and new exhibitions. And when we own the farm, focus on the green sciences, the cultural landscape, geology and food production. It's also, we call it the science center in the larder, because it's around the museum area. You have a really living and very active modern agriculture. And here we focus on the industrial history, but also we focus on mathematics. We, in the exhibitions, which we call Abel's sketchbook, we focus on the interaction between science and art and technology. And we also have a brand new and very modern planetarium in this department. So why are we here?
Why are we here? That's the main question. And of course we won the Megalati Award last year, but not only a European reward. As a new museum, we were glad that we also was appointed a Museum of the Year in Norway. And the reason for that was our way of thinking about museum, that the visitors are invited to touch, take part and explore. And in that way we are breaking new grounds as a museum. And as a science center, what we will talk more about, we are also new in that we combine local history and local tradition into the science center. But that we are given these awards by serious judges that comes to us and survey us. But what about the audience? What do they think about these things? So we also have them in mind, and we have a special interest in letting the young people, the children coming. And one of our magazines in Norway chose us as one of the most charming museums for children in 2009. And that was okay as well for us.
Yes, but how did it start? And the buildings, as we show you earlier, it's dates from 1995 and 2002. But we started, our first project was to restore a historical farm and make the authentic farm into a living historical farm. And here are some pictures from the farm and outside and inside. But the starting point was that in 1985 we got a mission that to build up a museum to document the technological development of the modern agriculture. And we also soon had the idea that we don't want it only to collect items, but it was very important for us to show how these items work and how the work was done. And, if possible, let the public take part in the activities and in the work on farm. And especially children and families were pointed out as our main target groups. And we recognized very soon the importance of showing just how things work. And through this experience, we reached our teaching philosophy. I think some of you have heard it before and maybe use the same philosophy, learning by doing. And we also learned the importance of interdisciplinary subjects and perspectives, mixing cultural history with science and social science. But then when we were going to build new exhibitions, we got a new exhibition hall or money for that, we had to think how are we going to make the new exhibitions? Because how can we take care of our experience of an outdoor museum in a way, with activities, into an exhibition inside? We didn't want to make more of this kind of exhibitions because here you just see but don't touch. It's for some museums that's maybe the most convenient way to do it, but that was not the way we wanted to do it. And how? So, we were going to fill this exhibition hall. Do we have to rethink our exhibition language? Make it in another way. And what about the science centers? Could we learn something from the science centers? Because they use interactive exhibits in their centers and in their exhibitions. So we started to think about, well, what is our items? It's especially connected to agriculture. And how can we also get the public, and especially children maybe, to understand the technology in the items that was used of the Jaeren farmers? And here is some, for instance, they have to use a tripod with different blocks when they was going to move big stones to clear the fields. And what if the boy asks, how can I move that big stones? Maybe we can build an experiment inside that you can really experience and feel how it is to move those big stones. So maybe you have seen a different similar experiments in other science centers, but just to use the blocks and ropes to pull yourself. And just ask if it's more difficult to use a 5-rope block or a 3-rope block. What's the easiest? And then, in that way, we thought it must be possible to combine history and, for instance, science and technology. So, in 1998, we then asked the government for some money to make a pilot project for science centers in Norway. And at that time, at the late 1990s, science centers was a new thing in Norway. It was not many science centers. And we applied for 11 million Norwegian crowns, and we were lucky. We really got that money. And the government said, good, we want a pilot project, and we want a museum to make a science center, and we want to, in a way, find out if it is possible to combine these two traditions. So then it was the first exhibitions on Science Farm that was then completed from 2002 to 2005. And we also put a new vision that we wanted to create a meeting place between culture, nature and technology and wake the interest for knowledge, research and education in our region and especially stimulate the children and youngsters' curiosity and interest in science. And at that time that was corresponding with the politics of the government. They saw that many that the interest in science was declining and they had to do something with it. So as I said, how could we put together the history of the region and tell the history of the region through interactive exhibits, and how could we link that to the, for instance, to the physics? As we, it's another example that when you, the farmers have to clear their fields, you can also use this in when you are teaching physics. And okay, what are they doing? Yes, they are taking the moment equal force multiplied distance into practical use. And I am quite convinced, and I many of the teachers has also been convinced that those children that are really doing and feeling this, they understand a lot more of that physics than when they just see it in the classroom. And they also remember much more the history of how the Jaeren farmers clear their fields, because they really done it. And we have some other examples too.
Yes, because they don't only clear the field, but they live there as well. And at the top here you have a typical Norwegian timber house, and it's especially the house from Jaeren and how to experience that. We have made a model in 1 to 10, and when you come to the museum you have to build that. It's put away in this, on the shelves, and you have a building plan, and either you are grown up or children, you get a helmet and you have to build a house in a half an hour. And that's quite a challenge, and it's teamwork, and there are some stones you have to use as well. And afterwards, with school classes, you can do some mathematics and calculation around it. So it's another way of experience architecture and building. And we have more examples of how we work. From the science factory, the local connection is to take the tradition of that, that area. And it started the industry around 1800 with pottery production, handicraft. And this is still a tradition in making china in a modern way. So to the left, you can experience making this in the handicraft way. On the right, we have used this as an exhibition about modern industry, how you put the different lines in production and put one worker to each station. So, and that way we combine historical knowledge with local tradition. And to say a bit more about how we are making this exhibit, because we started with just the two of us, but we are more people at the time, and we have the technicians, the skilled workers, different disciplines, and we have been making much of these things ourselves in our own workshop. And as an example here, the Chacard loom, you know it, and it was used in local factories. What we would do with this was to use it as an example of the first computer, as it is as well, with the cards making the pattern. And we studied this loom, and we found out what was the technology that we wanted to use. And we had the skill to make it, but we had to contact a designer who know how to make patterns and how does this function. And together we made it to be an exhibit that's now in the in the science factory. And at the picture here we have Queen visiting this year, and it's been running for 2 years now. So, and one of the good things about making things yourself is that our technicians, they are on the house. It's sustainability about exhibition. You have to make things that are functioning all the time, so you don't have to put up a note that it's out of order. So, but what is the teaching philosophy?
Well, the teaching philosophy, based on our experiences, both outside and inside, it's very simple, and I think many of you have heard it before, but it's that I hear and I forget, I see and I remember, I do and I understand. It's simple and it works, but it's not enough.
No, but man cannot understand before he can use the knowledge, and in a new situation. And again, we have an exhibition in the Science Factory about Leonardo da Vinci and his models, and here's the first car. It's a quite old one, and it's a spring that makes it move forward. And the children, they are making a mousetrap car with that technology. And then they have a race afterwards, and then they have used this knowledge, and perhaps they understand and remember better.
We said that family groups was one of our main target groups, and what also is important with interactive exhibitions is that it creates dialogue between generations, and that's also very important for us, that they do things together. And especially we see that many, both parents but also grandparents, comes with their children and grandchildren and are really engaged in our exhibits. And we have also a tradition that when a school class visits one of our localities, they get a free card for the museum the rest of the year. And what this our guides then notice is that the children come with their free card and are very proud, and then they take their children, their grandparents and parents and uncle and aunts with them, and then they are something, the guides in the exhibitions. For what also is important for us to know, do the children really learn something in these exhibitions, or have they just fun? But we think it's very important to have fun in the museum, and if they can learn something when they have fun, then it's very important. But we have a wide range of different subjects and themes in our exhibitions. So we also have to work together with people that have special knowledge outside our institution. So for instance, in the Science Factory, we have an exhibition and some exhibits on the brain. And then we have to work together with a professor at the University of Oslo, who had to, in a way, show that it's well, what we are telling is right. And for instance, on the science farm, we have a very close cooperation with the research institutes in agriculture.
And we are growing those tomatoes. They are part of our exhibition. We are sorry that we couldn't bring you some tomatoes today, but at the moment they are quite small and we don't have tomatoes. I thought of buying some again, but now you know we have none.
That, of course, very important is also to raise money. And for instance, the sponsors are very important. And especially when we built the science factory, and then we had to engage a sponsor or a fundraising committee to get the money for the exhibitions and the planetarium. And here is one of the most important sponsors, with a small girl that was, in a way, launching the planetarium, got the name after his company. Well, then we can discuss it. That's right, but it's another discussion, or an important discussion.
And when we will close now, the time is nearly
up. Yes, but I just have to say one thing, because inspired from Professor Gala yesterday, he mentioned the United Nations Millennium Goals. And 4 days ago, we opened a new exhibition just about that Millennium Goals. And that exhibition is also interactive. It is made as a game board, and you can pull the dice and see, are you lucky? Then you will get in the industrial country, or are you unlucky? Then you will come to the and do something in the developing countries. So it's and I think it's very important that the museums are taking up important subjects in our time today.
Yes, and then we will just end with a small video, 15 seconds, that shows the collaboration with the community, with the elder, because We have the factories making textiles, clothing, and we make a catwalk, not like we saw earlier today, but in another way. Our guys are the models, and the audience are the people who own the clothes. They have lent it to us for the occasion. And that's, and for the first time, the old ladies living around this site and dare to come in, because it's quite modern in many ways. So we try to interact with all kinds of public.